Now, let's look at the computation of the net premium reserves for different kinds of policies. So what is this net premium reserve? We are looking at it as a prospective reserve, which means the expected present value of the future benefit minus the expected present value of the future incomes, which is the premiums. So this is what we are calling as a net premium reserve. And because we are using the word net premium, there is no allocation for expenses in the reserve computation, right? It's only the premium and the death benefit, or and the claims, expected cost of the claims. And the premium that we are talking of here is not the actual premium, it's a notional premium, which is purely computed on the basis of the reserve. Whatever is the reserve basis that we are making, which is nothing but, well, here it's a net premium that is getting computed, and that net premium itself is getting used for the computation of the reserve. So here the notional net premium, whatever we are computing, is the future income element, right? If you look at it, this is the future income element of the reserve, which would generally be lesser than the actual premium that we are receiving, because this actual premium would have been computed taking into consideration the expenses as well as the future profitability of the insurer as well. But this premium, net premium, is getting computed in such a way that it will cover the cost of expenses of the claim, the cost of the future claims only. Now, for that kind of policy, let's try computing the premium reserves. So if I start off with the typical endowment assurance, right, I look at with an endowment assurance policy for N period or N year policy. So if I talk about a life whose age is currently X, he has taken a policy for N year period, where on death there is a death benefit of 1, and on survival up to N years there is a survival benefit of $1 that would be paid. And here the level premium P is paid annually in advance. So it's like an annuity due for the entire duration of the policy. So typically the reserve for this particular policy, I'll look at it as VX colon N. And I'm trying to compute the reserve after T years. So this is after T years, which means this is X when the policy has been taken. This is T, which is for now. And this is N, which is the maturity of the policy, which means still we have N minus T years for this particular policy. And by this time, the person's age has become X plus T. We require this for the prospective reserve because if we remember the formula for a prospective reserve, we talk about the expected future value of the claims. Now, expected present value of the future claims is nothing but AX plus T colon N minus T. And he has been paying a premium which has been decided at the beginning itself, PXN. The premium did not change now. It has been computed at that particular point in time. But still, now what are the present values of the future premium? Still, there are N minus T more periods. So whatever is the premium for the future, also I'll get it as X plus T colon N minus T. The premiums are paid in advance. Now, if you remember, the way we might have computed the premium when his age was X, at that point, I could have simply taken the benefit is AX colon N because it's an endowment assurance. The premium that is getting paid is PX colon N times the annuity, the present value of the annuity, which is AX colon N, which is paid in advance. Now, from here, I could very clearly say that PX colon N can very well be written as AX colon N divided by AX colon N with an advance payment. So that is what I would like to write here, the reserve VX colon N is same as AX plus T colon N minus T. Instead of P, I'm going to write AX colon N divided by small a, the annuity X colon N, times again the annuity X plus T colon N minus T, a present value of that. Now let me try simplifying this right hand side. It comes out to AX plus T colon N minus T, right? So this, if I am trying to multiply, if I am trying to multiply this, I could see this. Okay, here probably I'll take one more step. Convert the present value of the life assurance benefit in terms of the payment. So AX, the conversion, there is, we have a conversion formula between AX and A colon X. We have written earlier that AX is same as 1 minus of DA colon X. Now the same rule I want to use here, wherein AXT colon NT, I'll typically write it as 1 minus of D times AX plus T colon N minus T. I'm converting it, the capital A form into a small a form. Here also I'll write 1 minus D times AX colon N divided by AX colon N multiplied by AX plus T colon N minus T. Now if you look at it, right, this entire thing is coming out as 1 minus of DAX plus T colon N minus T minus, let me simplify it now, AX plus T colon N minus T divided by AX colon N, and this gets simplified as plus D times AX plus T colon N minus T. Now these two are getting stuck off, which is giving me 1 minus of AX plus T colon N minus T divided by AX colon N. A very important relation. The reserve for an endowment assurance policy with a time period of N years at time T, if I am trying to find it, it is as simple as 1 minus of AX plus T colon N minus T divided by AXN. So which is nothing but the current present value. If you are looking at it, it's a present value of 1. It's the present value of 1 for all the annuity, present value of the annuity starting from time period T till the future N, divided by the present value of 1 right at the time of taking of the policy. That is what is the result that is coming out, which is a clear measure of the prospective reserve. And the good thing is, this logic I can extend it even to a whole life policy with the same kind of a rule, I can say TVX is nothing but 1 minus of A colon X plus, sorry, AX plus T divided by AX. This will work for the whole life policy and even for an endowment assurance not paid at the end of the year, but it is an immediate kind of a payment. So wherein I'll call it as TV bar X colon N. Even in this case, it gets the same. A bar, I'll take it as X plus T colon N minus T divided by A bar X colon N. Or even in case of whole life where the payment is happening immediately on the death, T V bar X, I can very well take it as 1 minus A bar X plus T divided by A bar X. All of them, at least for the whole life assurance as well as endowment assurance kind of policies, we can directly compute the reserve at time period T just by doing the ratio of two present values of the and two expected present values of two annuities. One is the one starting from the time of the policy in the denominator and the time at which we are finding the reserve as a part of the numerator, and that ratio is getting subtracted from 1 to find out the reserves associated with $1 of the premium payment. While this logic will work only for whole life and endowment assurance policies, for all others, especially when I am talking about monthly premium kind of a case, or probably term life assurance kind of a case, we do not see this kind of a relationship holding true. In those cases, I have to rely completely on the basics. Probably if I'm looking at the same TVX, if I'm looking at it as an monthly payment, now whatever is the death benefit, if I say that the death benefit is paid at the end of the period, then the present value is AX plus T, and look at the premium. Okay, there is a PX that is getting paid in an monthly installment manner, and whatever is the annuity that is still supposed to be paid is nothing but A colon X plus T. Now this much, there is nothing of simplification. At the max, if I want to write this, I could very well write it as AX plus T minus of M minus 1 by 2M. That's the only thing that I am writing, but there is no other simplification for computing the reserve for this. Similarly, when I am looking at the term insurance kind of a policy where the death is happening here, the same logic again. I mean, first principle will remain the same, AX plus T N minus T, but this is only relating to the death benefit. Whatever is the premium that we have collected at the time of initiation of the policy, and whatever is the payment that is required, what is the present value of the future premiums that is still required. Now this is associated with a term life policy. I can have a similar stuff for endowment, and the summation of these two reserves, will be equal to the reserves associated with the endowment assurance policy. But this is one way we can simply compute the prospective reserves, and this concept can very well be extended not just to the life insurance policies. We can even extend it to annuity, we can even extend it to critical illness. But in case of critical illness, instead of probability of death, I will try to replace it with the probability of diagnosis of a particular critical illness. But otherwise, the mechanism still remains one and the same. So here we really need to understand, especially in case of net premium reserves, what is the easiest way out to compute the prospective reserve. We see a direct application of just the present values, expect expected present values of the two annuities in case of whole life as well as endowment assurance kind of policies, but similar kind of relationship is not found in case of monthly premium as well as in case of term life kind of a policies. But still sticking to the basic principles wherein we are talking of expected future value of the claims payment minus expected future value of the premium received is what is still giving me the prospective reserve at the end of the period. Now, the same calculation can be done even in a recursive manner. What I mean by that is, based on the reserves that are there at the end of time period T, I can look at computing the reserves at the end of time period T plus 1. This is what we are calling as the recursive kind of calculation. So for successive integer durations, right, for successive integer durations, rather than doing the entire process, we can use a recursive relationship to typically find out the net premium reserves. But the only assumption being the basis need to be the same, the I at which the I should be the same, the mortality table that we are using should be the same, and any other assumption that we are using should remain the same. So let's try out what is that kind of a recursive equation that we are going to get, right? Now the first thing, if I start with a whole life, all right, we know that TVX is nothing but AX plus T minus the premium times AX plus T. The premium is computed at the time when the age was X. Now, I would like to look a little bit more for this, right? I want to break this. AX plus T is nothing but the present value of the death benefit that is going to be paid for a person who is aged X plus T. So what I want to do is I want to write it in terms of AX plus T plus 1. So for that I can say, okay, if I assume that the probability of death for this particular person is QX plus T. So at the end of 1 year, if the person is dying within 1 year, right, if this is the probability that a person will die within 1 year. So in that case, he will receive a payment of 1. And the present value of that payment means I am trying to multiply it by V. Similarly, the probability of survival for that person is PX plus T. And if he is surviving, then the present value of the benefit that he is going to get along with the present value, the benefit that he is going to get, expected future benefits that he is going to get, I can write it as AX plus T plus 1. And if I want to find the present value of that as of today, I'll write it as this much. So AX plus T, I can very well write it in this way, because this is the probability of death multiplied by the death benefit, finding the present value of it because this is 1 year later. Similarly, the probability of survival multiplied by the value of the survival until X plus T plus 1 and discounting it by one more period now. So this is AX plus T. So I could have very well written this TVX. I will very well write it as QX plus T times V plus VPX plus T times AX plus T plus 1. Similarly, I can write let me add PX on both the side, the premium that I am receiving in time period T. So I'll write it as TVX plus PX. Now this part I'll keep it as it is. V times qx plus t plus v times px plus t times ax plus t plus 1. Now p, okay, here I can very well write, if I'm looking at so this is ax plus t minus px, okay, I'll write it as px times ax plus t. Also let me try writing it. What is the present value of ax plus t if I have to write it in terms of x plus t plus 1, right? If I have to look at x plus t in terms of x plus t plus 1, okay, it is 1 plus, if I am looking at ax plus t, it is nothing but, first of all, px plus t, the probability that the person will survive. And if he is surviving, the present value at that point in time is ax plus t plus 1, and I am taking the present value of this. So, which means instead of this, ax plus t, I will write it as 1 plus v px plus t. Ax plus t plus 1. I can write it. Cool. Now, and one more, I am adding a px to the last. Now, let me simplify the process. I'll take, okay, let me ignore the left hand side. So, I'll take the v out. When I am taking it out, it is nothing but qx plus t plus, I'll take from here, I'll take a px plus t out, right? From this and this, I'll take a px plus t out, because here minus px is getting erased off with plus px. So I'll take px plus t out, and what you could see is it is ax plus t plus 1 minus v px plus t ax plus t plus 1. This is what it is. Okay, so it is nothing but v times qx plus t plus px plus t times, look at this, ax plus t plus 1 minus of, okay, I have to take v out. So I have already taken v out, so it's not there. So it is px plus t times, okay, ax plus t plus 1 minus of this px times ax plus t plus 1 colon. So which is clearly saying this is nothing but t plus 1 vx. So which is very clearly coming out that tvx, the reserve at the end of time t plus the premium received during that particular period, is v times qx plus t, the probability of death at x plus t, plus the probability of survival times the reserve at the end of period t plus 1. This is the recursive. Now if I take this v down, it is nothing but 1 plus I. So I can very well write it as tvx plus px times 1 plus I. I can very well write it as qx plus t plus px plus t times t plus 1 vx. Now this is what we are explaining it as, a recursive relation. If the insurer is having a reserves tvx at the start of the year, which is nothing but the reserve at the end of the tth period, that plus whatever the premium that has been received at the beginning of this year, those two if he is investing, which will earn a return I, means whatever is the reserve amount along with the premium received in that particular year, if that total amount is invested at the rate I, this should be equal to The expected cost of death, here we are talking of cost of death being $1, so this should be equal to the expected cost of death benefit plus whatever is the reserve that is required at the end of T plus 1. For those that are alive, for those that are dead, it's the one which is the death benefit. For those that are alive, it should be the reserve that should be there. So the expected cost of setting up the reserve at the end of the year multiplied by the probability of survival plus the expected cost of death multiplied by the probability of death. So this is a simple recursive relationship which we see TVX plus PX. If this is invested at the rate I, the end of the period reserve should be, end of the period relation is, whatever are the reserves that are getting covered at the end of the year multiplied by the probability of survival in that particular year plus the probability of death during that particular year multiplied by the cost of death benefit during that particular year. So this is a recursive relationship, and what we see is this relationship you can use for almost all kinds of policies. I can very well use for endowment assurance, right? Only replacing all this. I can use it for endowment assurance. I can use it for pure endowment. I can use it for term assurance. Any such kind of policies, I can very well use the similar kind of a relationship. And this will help us in solving a lot of numericals quite comfortably, because once I know the reserves at the end of T period, I can very comfortably compute the reserves that are expected at the end of T plus 1. I don't need to redo the entire first basic principle formula for calculation of these kind of reserves at the end of the next periods. It simplifies the calculation quite comfortably for us. All right.